Hello everyone, welcome to today's video. So in today's video we will be looking into some of the more concepts related to method overloading or compile time polymorphism. Okay, so for that let us create a program, which is let's name it as let's say I'll keep that name as for today. So I'll keep it as method over. Okay, so method over. So this is just a test method that I, the test program which I am creating. Okay, meth over. So in order to check some of the more concepts which are related to Java, so I'll open this file. So open meth over dot java. Okay, so let us now write down the program here. So I'll just shift the windows so that it is convenient for us to look into it. So now, since I have created a program by the name meth over, so my class essentially would be meth over, and I will simply so these are some of the things that we have to keep in mind, because if the class C becomes capital, then it will become that it will not be, give us the correct output. So I will just close this particular class because we tend to forget the brackets also. So inside this, now today what we will be checking is, we will be checking whether we can overload the method or main method or not. Okay, so can we overload the main method? So this is basically we will be analyzing in today's video, as well as we will also be discussing about some more concepts related to method overloading. So for this, I will simply write down the main method, public static void main, and then within this string args, okay, arguments, and then I will simply write here a print statement, which is system.out.println, and here I will print, let's say this is main method. Okay, now in order to create a different, I mean overload this particular method, so what should be the name of my next method? So that also has to be the same name and within the same class. So let us create now another main method, which is by the name of main. So let us create it. So public static void main, it should have the same method signature, and here I am not passing any argument, I mean we are not passing a string argument, I am simply passing a, okay, int a. So the argument list is different here. Okay, and here I will simply write down a different print statement, which is system.out.println. Okay, and here I will write down that this is main to method. Okay, so now we will find out whether we can actually overload this particular method or not, the main method or not. So let us save this first. Okay, so I have saved it. Then I will run this particular program, meth over dot java. Okay, let me check. Okay, so unclosed string literal. So what does it mean? So that means in my main to method I have not closed this particular string. So let me save this again and I will compile this. This should not be giving me any error. Yes, it is not giving any error. So let me run this. Okay, so java meth over. So when I'm executing this, so when if you can see the output here, this is basically giving me the main first statement, which is there inside the main method. Okay, now if I want to call the second method, or if I want to call the second main method, please keep in mind that I have used the same names for both of them. Okay, so what do I have to do? I have to create an object of meth over. Okay, meth over m is equal to new meth over. And then, sorry, this is is equal to new math over, and I can use this particular object to call the next main method. Okay, next main method. And here what happens is, since I am using a particular argument here in the next main method, I can simply pass on any value I feel like here. Okay, so this is how I will call it. Now let's see if this is getting overloaded or not. That means if I'm being able to call the other main method or not. So let me run this. Yes, now when I'm getting this output, you can see that I am getting the main method initially, the statement which is inside the main method first, and then I'm getting the second one also, because I have created an object of the same class in which both the methods are, and I am calling the second main method using that particular object. Now one thing we have to keep in mind is that we can definitely have any number of main methods in the class by method overloading. That means we can also overload the main method, but since JVM always calls the main method which receives the string array as arguments only, that is why the first main method is basically printed. Okay, so this is entirely under JVM. So whichever main method consists of this string array as arguments, that will be called first. Okay, so you can also do this. You can also copy paste this here, cut paste this here, and find out which one will be your output. Then also you will not find much difference in the output. See, because the array of strings is basically in this method, that is why this statement would be printed first and then only this main method would be called. Okay, so we have to keep in mind that JVM will entertain the first request of that particular main method in which the string array, or which will receive a string array as arguments. So I think this point is clear when I am talking about that, whether we can overload the main method or not, or whether we can have multiple numbers of main method inside the same method or same class or not. Yes, we can have multiple number of main method and we can go on overloading the main method as and when required, but we have to keep in mind that whichever main method will have an array of a string array as an argument, that will be called first. Okay, so this was our first program. Okay, now this was the first concept which is related to today's video and method overloading. The next thing that we will be discussing is, now first let me delete this main method. Okay, the other main method, and I will simply remove this call. Okay, now let me keep here two different methods. Okay, so first one being void display, and here I am passing int a as argument, and similarly I will have a print statement here, system.out.println. okay, so here I am keeping it as int method. Okay, int method. And in the second one, I am keeping another display method, okay, with the same name of course, and here I am keeping as string a. Okay, string a, and let me rename this as, this is the string method. Now what happens is that when I am creating an object of this particular class and I'm trying to call, let's say, m dot display, let's say 10. Okay, so which method would be called? Since I'm passing an integer value, essentially this method should be called. Okay, let me execute and see. Okay, so this is the main method. Okay, let me comment this so that it is not creating any confusion in the output, and let me clear this screen. Okay, so now when I'm doing this, let me compile this. Okay, and now I am executing this. So see, when I am using this particular m.display10, that means I am passing an integer value to, I mean, to this particular call, okay, display method. So it will go, it will call the method which has an integer value as an argument. Okay, so hence the int method is printed. I mean, this particular line is printed. Now if I am having if I am passing a string value, let's say ABC, so this is a string. Okay, now let me save it. Now which method should be displayed? This method should be called and string method should be displayed. Okay, so let me see, if I am compiling this and I am executing this, now see what I am getting here is as the string method. So this is very common overloading, right? Now what if I am trying to do, I am just passing a character here, okay? I am not doing anything, but I am just passing a character. A is a character, and within quotes I will pass, okay? Within invert, this is how we pass a character. So I will simply pass a character here. So what do you think will happen now? Okay, now let me save this. All right, let's see what output it gives me. So see, it is giving me a int method. Okay, now this int method, that means this is printed. Okay, so when I'm passing a character, it is passing, or it is printing this particular or it is calling this particular method. Now why does it happen? This happens because we have an important concept which is known as automatic promotion, or sometimes we also call as typecasting, right? You have already done it, typecasting. So typecasting in this particular in Java we call it as automatic promotion. That means, and how does this happen? So if we have let's say I'm commenting this line so that you remember these things, okay? So if we have byte, okay, if we have a data type of byte, it is automatically getting converted to short, which is again getting converted, which can be converted to int, and int in turn can be converted into long. Okay, so this automatic promotion is that one type is getting promoted to another type implicitly if no matching data type is found. Now suppose here in this program what I did was I passed a character, okay, I passed a character, but is any of the arguments in this method has a character data type? No, right? So since the matching data type is not available, the character would be promoted to the next data type which is available in the method, if at all it is available. Okay, so if I have to represent a character, so character is automatically getting promoted to int in the next part, and the int can be converted into float, okay, or int can also be float, or int can also be converted into a long, okay? So it depends whatever you are using, okay, or int can also be converted into a double. So if any of the matching type for int is not available, then it is automatically promoted to a float data type or a long data type or a double data type. So this is how your automatic promotion takes place. So since I'm passing a character value here, okay, now this character does not have any matching data type in these arguments of the present methods in this particular class, it is automatically getting converted to int, and since there is a matching int method, it will simply print whatever is there within this particular display method. Okay, now again your long can be converted into float, okay, long can also be converted into float. So if I'm keeping it, I'll write it in different, you, and this you have to remember, that means this is the rule of the compiler, okay, they generally do this, and long can be converted into float or double. Okay, so this is how the hierarchy follows. Now we have to imagine again float. Float is again converted into double. So this is automatic promotion. Okay, so whenever there is no, if I'm passing a floating variable, floating value or floating number, float base number, so if none of the methods arguments have this particular data type, then it will be promoted to double. So that is implicitly, it happens implicitly. Okay, so here in this particular example, if you have seen this character A that I am passing is automatically converted to int data type, okay, and this method is called and printed. Okay, so this is how things work. And there are other rules also, that if something can be converted into string or some other values, so those things, there is a list, so you have to go it on your through your own. But these are very very common types of promotion that we see in our programs. So this is the second concept, which is related to method overloading. That means automatic promotion. Now if we are talking about promotion, let's say we should also know that the string, all the classes irrespective of whether they have extended or inherited something or the other, something or other from a class, it is also mentioned in my last video. So all the classes, they inherit some other class. Okay, if we do not explicitly mention that which class it is inheriting, that means it is inheriting the object class. So likewise, if I'm considering a string, okay, if I'm considering a string, then basically its parent is your object. Okay, so it is extending or it is inheriting the properties of the object. So object is the parent class of all classes in Java. So if we are not considering, so when I'm mentioning that meth over, right, so it is not showing that I have extended anything, so it is not extending anything, right? So implicitly it is extending the object class. Now if we look into a let's say if I'm taking into consideration an object, okay, let's say object. So I have mentioned here as the object A, okay, and now let me print here A, B, C. Okay, so this is the string that I'm considering, string, and let's say I'm keeping here as int, right? So now let me compile and run this and see what I get. So see, it is giving me the object. Since there is this, I'm passing it as string, and there are no string data types in this particular arguments which are present in the methods. So automatically, since I have already mentioned that string, that object is the parent class of all classes, okay, so for string also we will have to consider the parent or the promotional data type as object. So it will simply call this particular method and my int method will be printed. Okay, so this we have to remember. Now let me consider another example with this object. Okay, so if I'm having object A and string A, right, object A and string A. Now object, as already mentioned, this is the parent of string. I also have the child, which is string. So object, which is parent, so this is the parent, okay, and this is the child, so both of them are present. Now when I'm passing a string data type, I mean string value in my arguments, so which one do you think would be called, whether parent would be called or child would be called? So let us see how, what is the output that we get. So if I'm giving Java C and then I'm executing this, so it is giving me the display statement which is inside the child method. Okay, so this is also a property of Java, which says that while resolving overloaded methods, suppose there are two different overloaded methods, compiler will always give preference for the child type argument then compared with the parent type argument. So child will be given more preference, okay, than your parent. When it comes to overloaded methods, because it is like you won't disturb the parent, right? If your work is getting resolved with the child, why would you go and disturb the parent? So since if I'm passing a string value, immediately it will compare the parent and the child and the method, which is basically the having the child data type or child class, it will be printed first, okay, or it will be given preference. Right, so this is the third concept that we have discussed, that automatic promotion takes place between the data types, and string is basically a child of the object, and if there are two overloaded methods which has the parent and the child, then the child method would be given more precedence. All right, so the next thing that we will be discussing is okay, in before we go ahead with the next concept, so we should also remember that there is another concept which I think all of us have done, which is known as string buffer. Okay, so this is also a child of the object. Okay, so now what I'll do is I'll simply use string buffer here, okay, as the data type. So string buffer A. Okay, whereas the child will remain as string A. Now when I'm trying to compile this, essentially the second method would be printed. Okay, when I'm trying to execute this, the second method would be printed because I have passed an argument as a string variable. Right, now if I want to call the first method, what I have to do is I have to simply use a new string buffer. Okay, new string buffer, and within this let me pass the variable. Let's say I'll pass simply ASD. Okay, and right, so when I'm doing this, what I'll get as an output is that my first method would be printed. Okay, so this is also a child class of this particular method. So since my first statement is giving, I'm passing a string variable, so this will be printed first, and in the next one, string buffer, this is printed the in the second. Okay, now what if I am trying to print null, okay, or I'm passing null in as an argument. I'm passing null as an argument. Okay, yes, null. So when I'm passing null, you have to understand that here the compiler has a chance of getting confused. Okay, so see, reference to display is unambiguous, and m.displayNull, both method display string buffer in math over and display string in math over match. Okay, so here when I'm passing null, here my compiler is getting confused as to whether it should refer to string buffer, the first method, or it should refer to the second method. So we have to understand that it is basically we use this string buffer as an child class or child method or child data type to the object class. Okay, so and whenever we are using this particular null at this point of time, there is a chance that your system might get confused, or your program might get confused, or your compiler gets confused, and it will throw you an error. Okay, so this we have to keep in mind. So let me again show you how this works. So this is how it will work. So we have to be careful while we are using both string buffer and string in the same within the same class, because if we are want to pass any null values, then it might get confused between two different methods, two different overloaded methods, and it might not give you the desired output. Okay, now moving ahead with the fifth concept related to method overloading is that if we are using different data types, okay, so if we are using basically altering the sequences of data types. Okay, suppose here what I'm trying to do is I'm giving two different arguments, which is float b, okay, and here I'm simply reversing this, which is float a comma int b. Okay, so now what I'll do is, let me just remove this. So what I'll do is I will simply use m dot display. Okay, suppose I am using 5, 10f. Let's say if I'm representing a floating point number, it should give, you should use a point also, okay, decimal also. So let's say 10.5f. okay, so here if I am trying to execute this, let me run this first. Okay, if I'm trying to execute this, so first of all what will happen, it will match the data which is there, data type which is there. So the first value is int, so it will call the first method. Okay, sorry, okay, int a, is it there? Yes. So here now see, since the first data type is getting matched, so the first method would be printed. Now if I want to call the second method, what will happen? M dot display, I have to use the other way around, right? 10.5f, 5. Okay, so now if I run this, this should give me the second method, right? And this will give me the second method as well. So the first call is for the int method and the second call is for the string method, right? Now what if, so these two are okay, but what if I am trying to, let me comment this. Okay, now what if I am trying to pass two integer values, m dot display, let's say 10, 10. Okay, so what if I'm trying to display two integer values? Let's see if I can do that. I mean, pass two integer values. Let's see if I can do that. So when I'm trying to do this, it will give me an ambiguous error saying that this is not possible. That means you cannot pass two integer values. Okay, now why we cannot pass this two integer values? Okay, this two integer values, basically if we are trying to do this, okay, first of all it will be matched with this, okay, 10, 10. Yes, there is an integer a, okay, the other one is also 10, so this one is capable of holding a floating point number. Okay, so this will be automatically promoted, right? This 10 number would be promoted, this integer value that I'm trying to pass, it will be promoted to a floating point number. So I think this will be printed, right? Now it will consider the second method also, check the second method also, because the name is same. So when I'm trying to check for the first one, so this is an integer variable, I mean this is an integer value that I'm passing, okay, and this is a floating data type, so this integer can also be automatically promoted to float, okay, and the second one already is an integer, so this is also an integer, right? So this particular method is also satisfying the conditions, as well as this is also satisfying the conditions. Okay, that means these two values are automatically promoted to the respective data types, and these data types are capable of receiving these arguments. Both these two methods are capable of receiving the arguments. That means what? That both these statements would be printed. Okay, And this is basically what? This is an ambiguous situation. Both the methods cannot be called at one time. Hence, if we are having multiple number of arguments, then this type of method overloading is not possible. Okay, where automatic promotion is done. So we will not be able to use this these things under any circumstances. In what scenario can we use? Suppose I have a different data type altogether, maybe then this error will not show. So let us see whether I am able to get it or not. So I have changed this particular data type to string. Okay, change this one to string. So if I'm trying to do this, let me run this math over. Okay, so see, the next method now gets printed, right? Because both this particular data types are capable of holding the integer values. So hence this particular method would be printed. So if we are using multiple number of methods or multiple arguments in multiple overloaded methods, we have to make sure that we do not use the same method. Okay, I mean, we do not use the same data types in case of multiple arguments. Okay, so this is the primary difference. And one last concept that we have in case of overloading is when we are using the var args. Okay, so this is a new addition to Java. Okay, and var args, basically it is represented, let me just keep here simple. So void display, I'll keep it as int a. Okay, int a, and this is the integer method, and here I will be using as int dot 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 and space a. Now what do you mean by this three dots is that it will be accepting zero or multiple number of arguments. Okay, so if I'm using something like m dot display and I'm using 5, okay, then initially the first method would be called, let me execute and show. The first method is called. Now suppose I have an argument which has, let's say, 10 60. Okay, now I'm passing multiple values here, but here we do not have any such provision of capturing multiple values, but your var args will be capable of capturing multiple arguments, so multiple values for the arguments. So let us see. Yes, so since this is capable of capturing all the three arguments here, so the second method would be called. Now if I am passing nothing, okay, then what happens? If I am passing zero arguments, okay, there are no arguments, then also my second method would be called. Okay, so see, string method is printed twice because here initially using var args I used multiple values as arguments, and in the second one I am passing zero arguments. Okay, so var args can be used to capture multiple arguments or multiple values. So these are the different concepts that we learned today in case of method overloading. We talked about whether the main method can be overloaded, and we saw that we can have multiple number of main methods within the same class and we can go on overloading. However, the compiler, or however, JVM will be given preference to that main method which has an array of strings as the argument list, okay, or in its arguments. The second concept we talked about is our automatic promotion, and within automatic promotion we saw that if we are passing a character value, it is automatically promoted to int. Okay, and we also saw how if we are passing a string value, it is automatically promoted to object if the data matching data type is not present. Okay, because object is the parent of all classes. We saw how to work with string and string buffers. Okay, we also saw if there are multiple number of arguments in the overloaded methods, then their data types essentially should not be the same type, it should be different, because if the variable, if the values could be promoted, or if the data types can be promoted and they can yield the same, give the same result, then those two methods will be creating an ambiguity for the compiler. Okay, and we also saw how we can work with varargs. Okay, so these are some of the extra concepts which are related to method overloading. In my next video, we will be talking about method overriding in details. So that is all for today. Thank you.